much, Brother Ofori. Thank you so much for leading us into a time of prayer.
Thank you so much for leading us into the time of prayer. I didn't make sure you could leave the Facebook Live. So thank you guys all for joining us in the service. Thank you, Brother Ofori, for joining us in the service. Let's invite many more others to join. Let's invite many more others to join in the service. So thank you so much for your time and for your effort to join us. Today we are starting a new series.
Yesterday, today, and forevermore, what you say is what you do. You never fail, you never change. You are faithful till the end. Faithful God, I worship you. I worship you. You're too faithful to fail me. You're too faithful to disappoint me. You've proven yourself in my life, and I've come to realize you're too faithful to fail me. Too faithful to fail me. Oh Jesus, you're too faithful to disappoint me. You've proven yourself in my life, and I've come to realize you're too faithful to fail me.
Watch you.
permitted to leave me. Oh, Jesus, you're too consistent to leave me halfway. What you start, you always finish. Lord, I've come to realize that you are too faithful to fail me. What you start, you always finish. Lord, I'm here to testify. You're too faithful to fail.
Opportunity to come before him once again. Wonderful audience, God richly bless you for making time to join us. We are so opportune, we are so blessed to have you and to see you in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank God for your families, we thank God for another day, for giving us the opportunity to bring to you the unadulterated word. If you are watching me, I want you to share the page, share the video. Create a watch party with your friends, with your families, and encourage them to watch us on YouTube, on Facebook, and also on Zoom Live. Today, by God's grace, we are going to continue the series that we started yesterday. We started a week ago on return, on the return, coming back to the Lord. And I believe strongly that the Lord wants us to come back to Him. God wants us to come back to Him. God wants us to return back to Him. And God is still raising the Jeremiah of our time, the weeping prophet, to still speak to us and to still talk to us of us returning back to Him. And I want you to know that it is not too late returning back to the Lord. It is not too late. It is not too late to return to the Lord. It is not too late. And so if you are watching me today, I'm here to challenge you and to challenge your faith, and to tell you that it is not too late to return unto the Lord. It is not too late. In case you are watching me and you think it is too late, I'm here to challenge you and to tell you that it is not too late to return back to the Lord. And so today I'm going to continue the series on what we started, the return, coming back to the Lord, part two. And so wherever you are watching me, I want you to lift up your voice and begin to thank the Lord for another morning. You want to thank the Lord for preserving your life throughout the day, throughout the night. If I not be for the Lord, we will not be here today. So you want to lift up your mouth and say, Father, I thank you for seeing me through the night. Thank you for the privilege of being alive and to be counted among the living. You want to lift up your voice and say that prayer. And say, Father, I pray and I thank you for waking me up. I thank you for my children. I thank you for even the food that you put on my table. I thank you for my going in and my coming out. I thank you for your covering. I thank you for your protection. I thank you for your guidance. I thank you for even the privilege to be alive. It is not everybody that God has privileged. And so, Father, if I'm alive today, I have every reason to thank you. You want to lift up your voice and say that prayer and say, Father, I just want to thank you for even the privilege to hear your word this morning, the privilege, oh God, to be counted among the living. Maybe you are watching me, you don't see the need to appreciate the Lord, but I want to tell you that there is a need. It is only the living that can praise God. And so I want you to understand that many people went to the hospital yesterday, some during the month. Some were attacked by coronavirus and they died. They also had faith that they would cross over. They also had faith that they were going to see the end of the year. But the end of the year didn't come to meet them. And so if you are alive, it means that there is hope. And so you have every reason to appreciate the Lord. You have every reason to thank Him. And so I want you to thank Him and bless Him. Appreciate Him for His faithfulness. Had it not been for the Lord on our side, on you and I, our side, wouldn't have the privilege of coming before him today. And so I wanted to thank him. Thank him for your children, even for the fact that your children go to school. There are so many children who may not have the opportunity to go to school. And so if you are in school, you have every reason, your children are in school, you have every reason to thank the Lord. You have every reason to appreciate the Lord. And secondly, the fact that you are able to even feed and to be able to eat, you have every reason. The fact that the Lord delivered you from that accident, the fact that the Lord delivered you from that accident, the Lord delivered you from that shame, you have every reason to show him gratitude. And so if I'm in your shoes, I will lift up my voice and I will thank the Lord. The Bible says even in our trials, in our challenges, all things are working together for our good. And so I will want you to lift up your voice and appreciate the Lord. Thank him for his faithfulness. Thank him for his love. Thank him for his grace. Thank him for his mercy. Thank him for his love. Lift your voice and appreciate the Lord. Bless him in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Father, we give you all the glory. Father, we give you the praise. We thank you for today, Lord. It is not by might, but it is by power. Lord, we give you all the glory in the name of Jesus Christ. The Bible said at the mention of the name Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus, we thank you. King of glory, we worship you. We thank you. Now, once again, I want you to pray. The Bible said he is willing and just to forgive us of every sin. And so you want to pray this morning and say, Father, wherever I have gone wrong, whatever I have done, be it consciously or unconsciously, in my thoughts, in my mind, Lord, have mercy upon me. Lord, forgive me. Cleanse me. Wash me. Purify me. Justify me. Whatever I have done, O God, Lord, have mercy upon me. You want to pray that prayer because he is willing and just to forgive us. It doesn't matter what we think we have done. If only you can come to him, he's willing and just to forgive you. I don't know you by name, but if there is something that you think you have done, he's willing and just to forgive you. He's willing and just to receive you. Just open your mouth and just bless the name of the Lord. Just appreciate him for his faithfulness, for his love, for his grace, for his mercy in the name of Jesus Christ. I wanted to continue to pray and invite the presence of the Holy Spirit into this meeting, that the Spirit of the Lord will have preeminence over today's gathering. The Bible says that the gathering shall not be unto man, but the gathering shall be unto him alone. So we are praying this morning and we are saying, Father, let the gathering be unto you. Move in your might and power. Touch the sick. Heal the sick. Anyone that is sick, Lord, we pray that may you heal them. May you touch their infirmity in the mighty name of Jesus. Spirit of God, we pray for utterance. May we not speak what you have not directed us. May we not speak our mind, but may we speak the mind of Elohim. May we speak the counsel of God. We pray for the mighty hand of the Lord to move, the Spirit of the Lord to move, the power of God to move. We pray for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Let your spirit go before us, O God. Let your spirit stir up something in the lives of our audience, those who are watching right now, in the name of Jesus. If there is somebody that is on the verge of giving up, Lord, our prayer is that the Spirit of the Lord will stir them up. The Spirit of the Lord will rekindle them. The Spirit of the Lord will do a new thing in their lives. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you. Father, we give you praise. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. The Bible declares that when the sons of God, in Job chapter 1, the Bible said when the sons of God were gathered, Satan was also present in their midst. And so we are saying, Father, every activity of the enemy concerning today's meeting, let it be aborted in Jesus' name. Let it be truncated in the name of Jesus. Wherever they sit in council, whatever they plan, whatever they orchestrate concerning this gathering, we cancel it by the power of the Holy Spirit. We pray, oh God, that the blood of Jesus will take absolute control over this meeting. We pray that the anointing will break the yoke, will break limitation, will break every barrier in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We come against every setback concerning today's gathering. We come against every limitation concerning today's gathering. The Bible says, surely they shall gather, but it shall not be of me, saith the Lord. And so, Father, we declare that let utterance be our portions. Let your word come in preeminent and power in the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you. In Jesus' name, we have prayed. Lord, we give you praise. We commit the word of God into your hands this day. We pray for the utterance of your word to come with power. We pray for the utterance of your word to come with precision. Father, Spirit of the living God, direct us. Direct us to speak not our mind, but direct us to speak your mind. Lord, let your will concerning our lives be manifested. Let your grace concerning our lives be manifested. Let your mercy concerning our lives be manifested. We pray that, Lord, anyone that is watching us today, may the atmosphere and the anointing in this environment begin to minister to them wherever they are. And let their time of watching not be in vain. Lord, I pray, heal the sick, heal the crippled, heal the blind through these meetings in the name of Jesus. May people have an encounter with you like never before. Lord, give them testimonies. Give them testimonies. And at the end, Lord, we'll be careful to appreciate you for what you have done and what you are about to do. In Jesus' precious name, I call it down. Amen. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we started a series on coming back to the Lord. Today, we are going to look at the question. We're going to look at why people drift from the Lord. Why do people drift from the Lord? I told you when I started the series, I said, I know people who love God. They love the things of God until they backslided. And many people who love God are now very far from God. And I want to believe that they didn't backslide in a day. They did not backslide in a day. It took a process which they did not even take into consideration that this process was going to actually make them to backslide. And many of them today are far from the Lord. Maybe you may also be passing that same path today. And I believe that that is the reason why God has called me today to speak to you who is watching me via all the networks you are watching us from. And so I want us to look at and examine ourselves today. And if you wouldn't mind, I want us to look at a scripture in Luke chapter 8, verse 30. Luke 8, verse number 30. The Bible says, this was Jesus himself speaking. The Bible talks about the parable of the sower. Now, I want to read the entire parable so that you can understand where I am coming from. The Bible said that Jesus in verse 5, for the sake of those who may, I know you have heard the scripture before, but for the sake of the proper explanation, I'm going to read from verse 5. The Bible said, a sower went out to sow his seed. And as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down. and the fowls of the earth, the fowls of the air devoured it. And some fell upon a rock, and as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. And others fell on the ground and sprang up and bare fruit on a hundredfold. And when he had said these things, the request one, he cried, and he that had ears to hear, the Bible said, let him hear. And his disciples asked him, saying, what might this parable be? And he said unto them, the echo is okay, but Jesus is too much. And he said to them, and he said, unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parables, that seeing that they might not see, and hearing that they might not understand. Now the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. The seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are they that hear, then cometh the devil and taketh away the word from their heart, lest they should believe and be saved. They on the rock are they which, when they hear, receive the word with joy, and these have no roots. And that's my emphasis. These have no root, for while they believe, and in time of temptation they fall away. Now let me read the verse 13 again for the purposes of emphasis. The Bible says that, listen to what it says. They on the rock are they which, when they hear, they receive the word with joy. And these have no roots. They have no roots. If it's your own Bible, I want you to underline that word. They have no roots. For a while they believe, but when they are faced with temptation, they fade away. Now, one of the symptoms of falling away from the Lord, or turning your back to the Lord, is when you are not deep rooted in God. There are many of you who are watching me this morning. You are not deep rooted in the word of God. You are not deep rooted. You are not very deep rooted. You are shallow so far as the things of God is concerned. And I've been a pastor for a while. I've seen that many people who actually backslide, or who even leave churches, maybe they leave one church to another church, is because many people are very shallow, especially people who are quick to listen to people and make judgment out of what they hear, are people who are not very deep rooted in the things of God. Now, one of the things I want to establish here this morning, which I want you to understand, is that when I was a child of God, before I became born again, I was told that once you are saved, everything was going to be okay. You're going to be okay. Once you are saved as a child of God, everything was going to be okay for me. And so I believed in that lie, and I thought that being a Christian, all my problem was going to be solved. But no one had the audacity or the courage to tell me that the Christian race also came with testing. One of the things I wanted to understand as a child of God is that you being a Christian does not mean that you will not go through testing. There is a time of testing in the life of every Christian. Every Christian or every child of God will go through a time of testing. If you are a child of God watching me, or you are a Christian watching me, and you have not gone through any testing, then you have not yet started the Christian race. You are still warming up. Because every child of God will go through a testing period. Even Jesus himself went through that period. Abraham went through the period. Esther went through the period. Most of the disciples of Jesus went through. And so every child of God, every Christian, there's going to be a period of testing of your faith. And so if you are not deep-rooted as a child of God, you don't study the Bible, you don't go to church regularly to be deep-rooted through the preaching and the hearing of the word of God, in the time of testing, you will fall away. The reason why a lot of people in our time are falling away from the gospel and are hearing heresies, are hearing watered down gospel, is because many of them are not rooted. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the things I have, over my years as a pastor, which I have noticed, is that when you fail to know God for yourself, okay, when you fail to understand and know God for yourself, when the challenges of life comes, you will fall away. And so you need to understand that the Christian race is a race of testing. You'll be tested. Because you need to know God for yourself. You need to know God for yourself by understanding why I am paying tithe. You don't need a pastor to tell you to pay tithe. You should be able to know God for yourself, to be deep rooted in the things of God, to be able to know God for yourself, to know why are they telling me to pay tithe? Why must I speak in tongues? Why must I be born again? You must be deep rooted. Because, let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, the reason why people get offended easily in the faith, they get offended. This one say, oh, I am offended. I'm leaving the church. I'm leaving this church. When people get offended and leave a church, it tells you that they are not deep-rooted. Because if you are deep-rooted in the word of God, you will understand that offense is part of the testing. To be offended is part of the testing. To be criticized is part of the testing. The Bible said Jesus was like a lamb to the slaughter without a defense. He was like a lamb to the slaughter without a defense. And so you need to understand that criticisms and people undermine you and all that is part of the experience of walking with God. And so it is very important, let me say this, as a child of God, that when you are walking with God, you should have a conviction. You should have a conviction of your own. Somebody said, sang a song and said, I have decided to follow Jesus. Let the string play. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world. Decided
to follow Jesus, I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back, no turning back.
You see, what I'm saying is that don't just be a Christian. Have a conviction that no matter whatever you go through, you will serve the Lord. Whether you go through the high waters of life, whether you go through the storms of life, you will still serve the Lord.
My faith has found,
you can play that song,
a resting place.
Just play that song for me. Play that song. Just play that as a song. It's one of Sonny Badu's song. I just feel like singing it. That you will tell yourself that I have a conviction that I am unmovable in the midst of whatever I go through. Listen, I have seen people who have cancer. They have cancer. They are dying, but yet they will still believe and trust God. I have seen people who have no child. They don't have a child of their own. They've grown old, but their conviction tells them that they will serve the Lord until they die. The question I want to ask you today is that what is your conviction? Are you convinced? Are you persuaded that even in the midst of whatever you go through, you will still serve the Lord? That is the conviction that the Lord wants you to have. That is why I'm saying that you need to be grounded and rooted in the things of God, because testing is part of it. Testing is part of the walk. You will go through that marital problem, that marital situation. Will that marital situation force you to cheat on your husband or cheat on your wife? Are you deep rooted to the extent that you will tell yourself that no matter whatever I go through, I am not going to leave the faith. No matter the challenges, I'm not going to leave the faith.
My faith has found a resting place, nor in the valley, nor creek. I trust the ever-living one. His word for me sharply.
Oh, Jesus.
I need no other argument.
Oh, Shadaba. Shagabayataya.
The darkness glory.
There are a lot of people who have deviated from the Lord because they were shallow. They were shallow. They were not deep-rooted in the things of the Lord. And so the Lord is calling us back. The Lord is calling us back to Him. Then if you are watching me and you know, and you know that you have deviated, you deviated from Christianity, and maybe you are watching me, you have become part of a cult. And your convictions are different from the conviction of the Lord. Today, the Lord is calling you. The Lord is calling you. The Lord is calling you to come back to Him. Many Christians who are not biblically sound because they don't understand the word of the Lord and are not rooted in biblical doctrine are usually and easily persuaded by fables. They follow fables because they are not rooted in the things of the Lord. I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, the question I want to ask you today is that, what is your conviction for the Lord? What are your convictions? What are your beliefs? What do you believe? What are your convictions? What are your convictions? What are your convictions? No. What are your convictions? What are your convictions so far as God is concerned? What are your convictions? What do you believe? That no matter whatever I go through, I am not going to be persuaded by fables. That is why sometimes I find it very difficult when people listen to some pastors or some men of God and they tell them fables and they just believe. They tell them fables because they are not deep rooted. And I prophesy and I speak to you today. May you be rooted in the Lord. May your convictions be firm, and may you not be persuaded. May you not be persuaded. The reason why people are not stable in the faith and they keep being tossed to and fro and leaving one church and leaving one place to another is because many people are not biblically rooted in the word of the Lord. There are many believers and there are many Christians who have faded away because they are not rooted. Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you, lower it from me. There are true. One of the things I want you to understand is that there is a true gospel. There is a holistic gospel. And if you are not rooted in the word of the Lord, you might find yourself being falling away. You might find yourself being falling away. And when you are not rooted, anybody at all can convince you. Somebody from Jehovah's Witness can come and convince you. Somebody from another cult or another denomination, which is a cult or a cappuccino church, can come and convince you because you are shallow. Being shallow is a symptom. Once you are becoming shallow or you are shallow, it's an indication that very soon you are going to fall away. That is why Jesus said, they believe. After a while, when temptation and trials come, they begin to search for other things. There are believers who go to church, but because their conviction is not very firm and they are shallow, they, instead of they serving God, they even go to the stand of serving other gods when temptations and trials come their way. I'm telling you, there are people like that. They believe in God, but when they go through temptation and they go through trials, they go and serve other gods. They go to voodoo or juju for extra powers because of the challenge and the trials that they are going through. They seek other powers. They seek other helps. Why? Because your Christianity is not strong. You are shallow. And so you listen to fables. There are people who leave churches because somebody offended them, or a pastor made a mistake. Maybe a pastor did a mistake, so because of that, he said, I'm leaving the church. Or an usher or a member or somebody did something to you, then you say, oh, I am leaving the church. I'm leaving this church because this person has offended me. I'm leaving the church because this person has wronged me. I'm leaving the church because this person has done something evil to me. Listen to me, child of God. What is your conviction? What is your belief? Because let me tell you, Jesus said something. Jesus said, follow me as I follow Christ. Follow me. Me, your pastor. Follow me as I follow Christ. So offense is not a right reason to say you are leaving the church. To be offended or to be criticized is not the right reason. The only reason why you leave a church is when your pastor is no longer following Christ. When your pastor is no more following Christ, that's the only reason. People get offended. People leave churches because they are shallow. They don't have a conviction of their own. They don't have a conviction of their own. There are many Christians who, the reason why they don't even win spiritual battles. There are many Christians. One of the reasons why they don't win spiritual battles. And one thing, one prayer, they will keep praying without getting results. It's because many Christians, because they are not deep rooted in the word of the Lord, they are paperweight before the devil. Many of you are watching me. You know you are paperweight. You don't carry any weight. You only walk around speaking in tongues or pretending you know the scripture, but you are paperweight before the devil. You know that you are paperweight. You don't carry any weight because you're not deep rooted. You just follow the crowd. That is why there are many Christians who have not been able to build their personal Christian life. They've not been able to build their personal Christian life. When they go to church and their whole church or in a group, and we are binding devil. Oh, you think that they can pray a lot? They will pray. But when they go to their own home, they can't even pray. They don't have any Bible study time. They don't have a quiet time. They don't have a waiting time. They don't pray on their own. It is only when they go to church that they go and display their fake Christianity. They go and display their fake Christianity. But real Christianity starts when you are alone and nobody's watching you. Do you pray on your own? Do you fellowship on your own? Do you have a quiet time on your own? When was the last time you took your Bible and you read? There are Christians who don't have any prayer life. They don't have a Bible studies life. And so any wind of doctrine or anything they see on Facebook, or a man of God is preaching something that is nice, they are just easily carried away by those doctrines and they just follow them blindly. Don't just be somebody who is following the crowd. Learn to know God for yourself. Shallow people, they just follow the crowd. So this pastor is rebelling or doing something, they just follow him. This pastor is rebelling or doing something, they just follow him. Because all they do is that they are shallow. They are shallow. And I want you to understand that, listen to me, if you are not deep rooted and you follow people blindly, I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, it is one of the most dangerous things that you can do. If you remember the days of Moses, in the days of Moses, many people, they murmured against God. They murmured. And many of us, we still do that. People were shallow. They complain about everything about the church. People are very shallow. That is how they are. They complain, they talk everything about the church. They will complain because they don't have a conviction of their own. They complain. And it was like the days of Moses. They complain about everything until they created a calf to worship. And the Bible said many God involved in creating a calf And until Moses said, those who are on the Lord's side should come one, and those who are not on the Lord's side to go there. And those who followed the crowd, and when the Bible said the ground opened and they were swallowed because of their shallowness. They were not deep. Don't be part of people who complain and murmur. Those who are not rooted were the ones who killed Jesus. The Bible said when Pontius Pilate came out and said, should I kill this man or release Barnabas to you? The crowd said, kill him, kill him. Many people just followed the crowd. I want you to understand that following the crowd is dangerous. Be intentional in this year 2020. We are in the month of September till December. I want you to be intentional that I want to grow. I want to mature. I want to have roots as a believer. I want to have roots. I want to be deeply rooted. I want to be deeply rooted. Because let me tell you, if you are not deeply rooted, the devil will toss you to and fro. With any little thing, the devil will toss you. With any little thing, the devil will toss you. And so, God wants you to be deeply rooted this year. God wants you to be deeply rooted. God wants you to be deeply rooted. Don't be a paperweight Christian. Don't be a paperweight Christian. Because when you are a paperweight Christian, you become a target for the enemy. Any Christian who is a paperweight becomes a target for the enemy. Now, I'm going to read another scripture for us in Acts chapter 6, in Luke chapter 11. Luke 11, verse number 25. The Bible says, let me read from verse 24 so that it will be more clearer. And when the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places seeking rest, and finding none, he said, I will return unto my house whence I came out. And when he cometh, he findeth it swept and garnished. And so when you are a shallow Christian, you become empty and you attract space for that emptiness. Because any child of God who is deeply rooted is somebody who is filled with the Holy Ghost, filled with the word of the Lord. And so there will be no space for the enemy to enter. But when you are a shallow Christian, you leave a spiritual vacuum for the enemy to fill it with negative thoughts, with negative energy, with negative desires, which becomes a foothold and becomes a stronghold in your life. And so, don't be a child of God who is shallow. I don't want you to be shallow. This year, 2020, make an intentional decision that you want to be rooted in the things of the Lord. You want to be rooted. Because when you are a Christian and you are empty, you give room for the enemy to operate. You give room for the enemy to manipulate you. You give room for the enemy to manipulate you. And many Christians are being manipulated by the enemy because most of the time, they leave space because they are not rooted in the word of God. People who are empty Christians, they are very loud and they want to be noticed, but they don't have any substance. There are many pastors, many men of God, many people who want to be famous. They want to be recognized. They want to be seen. They want to be acknowledged. But they are not deep in the word. They are not deep in the things of God. And so, when the challenges of life come, you are susceptible for the enemy to manipulate you and for you to do certain things because you are not deep-rooted. You want to be popular, but you're not deep rooted. You want opportunities, but you are not deep rooted. You want privileges, but you are not deep rooted. You are not even ready for it. And so when the challenges of life come, it hits you and it exposes you. And so that is why God is saying that you need to be deep rooted. You need to prepare. Preparation is what meets opportunities. And so if you are not prepared and the opportunity comes, you will embarrass yourself. You will disgrace yourself. And that is what I'm talking about. Empty Christians. Christians who fall away. Christians who are shallow. They always are the type who want to be noticed. They want to be noticed by the pastor. They want to be noticed by the world. But yet they have no substance in them. They have no word in them. They have nothing in them. But yet they want to be noticed by the world. What do you have that you want to give to the world? God wants you to be filled with the Spirit of God. God wants you to be filled with the Word of God, with the love of God. And so, fill your time purposefully. If you are watching me today, I am encouraging you. Fill your time purposely. Look what it means to be. Fill your time purposely. Fill your time purposely. For instance, read your Bible. If you don't want to be shallow, study your Bible every day. If you don't want to be shallow, fill your activities with church. I especially in the UAE here, when Evans and Co. come and they want to work for God, I know people will tell you, you are here to make money, why are you wasting your time? But I'm telling you, fill your time with church activities. It's one of the ways that you can grow. If you fill your time with hearing the word of the Lord, reading the word of the Lord, studying the word of the Lord, yearning for the Holy Spirit, I am telling you, ladies and gentlemen, you will not just be any Christian, but you will be a Christian of substance. You will be a Christian who carries something. Now, when you read the scripture, I want us to read another scripture. Thank you, Holy Spirit. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 10, God wants us to be faithful to the end. Doesn't matter what you are being through or what you are going through, God wants you to be faithful to the end. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 10, I will read from verse 8 so that you can understand. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at the day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Paul said, do thy diligence to come shortly unto me, for Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world. Demas has forsaken me, for having loved this present world. Paul was speaking to Timothy. How Demas has forsaken me for loving the present world and is departed unto Thessalonica, Crescent to Galatia, Titus unto Dalmatia. There are many people who, because they are shallow and they are not deep rooted, they have left the word of God. They have left their calling. There are some of you watching me. You know that the Lord, you know, and you know that God loves you, and you know you have the calling of God upon your life. You know yourself. You know that you have the calling. You know that God's hand upon is on you. God's hand is upon your life. You know that you have a calling. You know that God has a purpose for your life. But because of the world, because of the worldly desire, because of friends, you are not willing to serve the Lord. You are not willing to come back to the Lord because of the world. Today, God wants you to come back. The world has nothing good to offer, my darling. Yes, you may think that the world and its money, friends, women, the club, the fun, They are nice. You are happy. The drink, the booze, the tramadol, the pleasures of this world. But I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, it will only lead you to the grave. It will only lead you to the grave. Don't allow the love of the world to be in your heart. Don't allow the love of the world, the corruption of the world. Because let me tell you, lust corrupts. Lust, they corrupt. And so it is one of the reasons why I believe strongly. So don't be a shallow Christian. Don't be a shallow Christian. Now, another thing I want to talk about, which is also another reason why a lot of people fall away from the faith, is their desires. Is their desires. And many of you have been following my series already that I've been talking about. Desires, the ones I do on Sunday, the flesh. But I'm going to speak a little on it, then we go on to the next point. You have to check your desires. What are your desires? What are the things that you think about? What are the things that when you are alone, you think about? Your desires. Now, go with me to 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter number 1 to 4. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. The Bible says, but there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who probably shall bring a damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that brought them, and bring upon themselves swift destructions. Many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. For if God spared not the angels, listen to what it says. If God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment. And so you need, this is warning concerning the apostate teachers. And the Bible says that we need to be very careful of, Second Peter, I was reading Second Peter chapter 2. Second Peter verse 1 to 4, sorry. Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power has given unto all of us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that had called us to glory and virtue. Now verse 4, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. The corruption that is in the world through lust. Now, you have to, as a child of God, one of the things that you need to take into consideration is to consider your thoughts and to consider your desires. There are many people who have a desire that is uncontrollable. When your desire becomes uncontrollable and your desire becomes strong and excessive, it will lead you to do things that you are not proud of. Are you desiring to get married? Are you desiring to get married at all costs? Your desire to get married at all costs will make every man that will come your way to sleep with you, because you are so desperate. And it is that desperation that will make men to use you, because you are desperate. And so you have to watch your desire. You have to watch your desire. The thought that comes into your mind. Does the thought of murder come into your mind? Does the thought of killing your husband, killing your wife? Does the thought of stealing? Does the thought of lying? Does the thought of rape? Does the thought of fornication? Does the thought of masturbation? The thought of lust, because lust has it all different forms. Whether it is the lust for money, fame, the lust for sexual lust, the lust for power, because these are the three things that destroy mankind. Sex, power, and money. Sex, power, and money. Sex, power, and money. These three things have always corrupted man. And that was what the Bible was talking about. The corruption of this world, the lust of this world. What are you lusting after? What are you lusting after? Are you lusting after power? To have power. Is that what you lust after? Or you lust after sex? Or you lust after money? If you look at the story of the prodigal son who eventually had to return to the father, you will see that he lusted after the material things. He lusted after money. He lusted after his own wealth. He wanted his wealth to be given to him so that he can go and spend it. He wanted to spend his money on money, sex, and clamor, the world, until the Bible said he lost everything. And so if you are watching me today and your mind and your heart is full of so much lust, if you have strange lust in you, you have to kill them now. You have to kill that lust, because it is a sign that you are falling away. I gave you the first sign. The first sign that you are falling away from the faith is what I said, that one of the signs is when you are not rooted in the word of the Lord. That's one of the signs. You are shallow. You are not rooted. The second one is that your desire, if you don't watch your desire and you don't kill that desire will kill you. Lower it, please. That desire will kill you. The desire will kill you. The desire will kill you. So make sure that you check your desires. What are the things that you desire? Watch your desires. Watch your lust. Watch your lust. Watch your lust. Because whatever you form in your mind, okay, whatever you form in your mind becomes your thoughts. And what you form in your thoughts becomes a foothold for the enemy to manipulate and becomes eventually a stronghold. And so you have to be careful. Your desires, what are the things that you crave for? Do you crave for the things of the kingdom? Do you crave for the things of God? Or you crave for money, power, sex? Those are the things that wake you up in the morning every day. Those are the things that make you to wake up every morning and to be hardworking. Or you crave for the things of God. You have to check your desires. What are the things that you lust after? The things that you lust after is very important to God. It's a sign that you are either backsliding or you are coming closer to the Lord. Do you want to, is it your desire to see the church of God grow? Like, for instance, yes, as a believer, it is, what are the things, do you lust to see that you are growing as a believer? You are growing as a child of God. Your family is growing your family is also growing and maturing in the things of God. Is it your desire to see the church building being built? Is that your desire? Or you go to church, the church building is dilapidated, the toilet is not there, the fan is not working, you don't care. When those things don't become your desire, it tells you that you are backsliding. You have lost it. Is it your desire to see that there is enough meat in the house of the Lord, there is enough offering, there is enough giving, to be able to take care of the pastor, to be able to take care of evangelism, to be able to take care of mission work? Is that what is on your heart? Is evangelism on your heart? Do you wake up every day and you long for souls to be saved? You long for men to be saved? You long for men to repent and to come back to God? Are they the things that you lust after? Are they the things that are your desire and that are in your heart? Those are the things you have to check. When your desires are entirely different from the desires of God, it is simply an indication to tell you that you are backsliding. You are backsliding from the faith. You are losing it gradually. So that is why I'm saying that whatever you are desiring in your heart and in your mind, that is not in tandem with the purposes of God concerning your very existence, then you have to kill it. You have to stop it before it is too late. Stop it before it is too late. Stop that evil desire. That evil desire to outdo somebody. That evil desire for what does not belong to you. Stop that desire before it is too late. Because that desire is going to consume you. That desire is going to make you to fall away from the truth and fall away from the Lord. And God doesn't want you to fall away. When you start feeling that way, it's a sign that you are backsliding from the faith. You are backsliding from the faith. You are eventually leaving the faith. You are eventually going to lose your salvation. That is why I tell people all the time that, listen, don't listen to those pastors who tell you can't lose your salvation because salvation is eternal. I'm going to be teaching on that on Sunday. Satan doesn't make you lose your salvation immediately. He makes it a gradual thing. You are losing it. Your desire, you are losing it. Then eventually you realize that you are empty. You have nothing. The Holy Ghost has left you. Jesus is no longer in your heart except you confess him back. The next one is bitterness. Bitterness, unforgiveness can also make you to backslide. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Bitterness and unforgiveness can also make you to backslide. Can also make you to lose your faith. People can demonically provoke you so that you can become bitter. Yeah. Satan can enter people and they can demonically provoke you so that you can become bitter. And it's all part of Satan's agenda to make you bitter. Because Satan knows that so long as you are bitter, it is one of the signs or one of the ways he can get you to backslide. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15. Hebrews 12, verse number 15. Hebrews 12, verse 15. The Bible says in Hebrews 12, verse 15. It says, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. Lest any root of bitterness spring up, trouble you. Thereby many be defiled. Lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you. Many people leave churches because of bitterness. They leave the church because of bitterness. They leave their marriages because of bitterness. They leave their company because of bitterness. Let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, when you become bitter, you cannot be better. And one of the agenda that Satan is using is in this end time is bitterness. He makes you bitter so that you can lose your glorious prophetic destiny that God has programmed for you as a child of God. When you become a bitter Christian and you become offended, you have wounds naturally as a child of God. You have wounds. And if you don't deal with the wound may never be healed. And it will affect even others. And one of the research I have done personally is that people who are bitter people who become very bitter, they are never happy people. People who are bitter, they never are happy. They are never happy. They are never happy people. And so, take away bitterness from your heart. Tell yourself, I refuse to be bitter. I'm not going to be bitter.
I'm not going to let the actions of people make me bitter. I'm not going to make the actions, the behavior of people, the way people look down upon me, the way people undermine me, the way people do things to me. I refuse to allow them to make me bitter. I refuse. Because if I am bitter, I cannot be better. I cannot be better. And I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, one of the strategies of bitterness and offense is to separate you from the fold. You know, when you take one broom, just one piece of broom, you can break it easily. Okay, when you take one broom, you will notice that you can be able to break that broom easily. But take about 100 of the same broom stick, the same broomstick, you will notice that it will be very difficult to break 100 broomsticks. And Satan knows that once he can use offense, he can use bitterness, and you are separated from the fold, he can attack you easily. And so the agenda of offense, the agenda of bitterness, is to separate you from the fold. And so I want you to be cautious. And I want you to understand that wherever there are human beings, so long as there are human beings there, people will hurt you. Anywhere you work, whether in an organization, whether in the church, whether wherever, it is not saints who are in the church. Let me tell you, angels don't go to church. Let me say it again. It is not angels who go to church. It is human beings who go to church. And so long as there are human beings there, so long as human beings are there, human beings are going to hurt you. People are going to hurt you. And so I need you to understand that so long as people are going to hurt you, you need to understand that if you carry yourself with so much offense, people will derail you from your prophetic destiny. The actions of people, the behavior of people are going to derail you and are going to make you to lose focus. Maybe you are watching me, you have trusted people. You trusted them so much, you gave them your church. You trusted them so much to have your back. But maybe you are watching me, somebody disappointed you, somebody stabbed you in the back. Somebody told a lie on you. Somebody gossiped about you, which was not true. They said things that was not true about you. And so, generally, something happened that generally vindicated you, that warrants that you should be bitter. But I'm here to tell you that, listen to me, people will fight you because of the favor upon your life. People will ridicule you. People will try to sideline you. And it is possible for you to become bitter. It is very possible for you to become very bitter in life because of the things that people will do to you. But choose not to be bitter. Choose to see them see you excelling in the midst of that situation. Choose to smile even in the midst of that situation. Choose to be happy even in the midst of that situation. Let your enemies see you and let them be confused and dumbfounded. That they thought that this thing was going to kill you, but rather it promoted you. I was telling somebody the other day that one of the things that helped me as a pastor is to channel my pain and that pain or whatever I'm going through as an energy to succeed. I channel the pain to succeed. And so channel your pain to succeed and prove your critics wrong. Prove them wrong and tell them that I am still standing in the midst of that situation. Remember what Jesus did. The people offended him. They spat on his face. They rejected him. But the Bible said on the cross, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do." How can a man who has been disappointed, disillusioned, and has gone through so many things, and yet he said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do." I know you are watching me. Your heart is full of heaviness. In fact, as I'm talking right now, your heart is so heavy because people have disappointed you. People have done things that is imaginable. You cannot even imagine that a human being can do that to a fellow human being. But I came here to tell you, I came here to speak the word of God to you. That yes, they may have disappointed you. They may have disillusioned you and they may have done things to you and they are now making it feel as if you are the problem. But I came to tell you that, listen, choose not to be bitter. 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 Tell yourself, I refuse to be bitter. I will not allow their actions to make me bitter. I will not allow their behavior to make me bitter. I refuse in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I will not be bitter. I refuse to be bitter in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I refuse to be bitter. Now, another sign. I'm going to be ending very soon so we can pray. Another sign. I'll continue next week. I'll give you two other signs. Then we are out. The next one is love. Love, 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 love. And I'm still using the same Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15. The same Hebrews 12, verse 15. Now, if you are watching me, let me use an example of married couples. One of the signs you see that a marriage is suffering, okay, when a marriage is suffering, one of the ways you can easily see is when the two people no longer give themselves love the way they used to give themselves love and attention. The same thing applies to when you are falling away from the truth and you are falling away from the Lord. Now, when someone is falling away from the Lord, one of the things that you see which is very predominant in their walk with God is that you will see that they no longer love God the way they used to love God. Yeah, they no longer love God. Their love for God diminishes because they have been hurt. Either they've gone through some hurtful experience or somebody has hurt them, somebody has done something for them. So their love for God dwindles. Their love for God comes down. And so one of my sincere prayer for you is that the same zeal, may God bring you back to your first love. I pray for you, somebody who is watching me, somebody who is listening to me. My prayer for you this morning is that may God bring you back to your first love. Bring you back to your first love. Because many people have left their first love. The way they used to be very zealous for God. The way they love God sincerely from their hearts. They love God. They are willing to sacrifice for God. They are willing to give to God. They are willing to pay their tithe. They are committed at church. Now you don't see those zeal in people anymore. You don't see that zeal much in people anymore. And so I want to encourage you. Come back to your first love. Where you were not told to fast, but you fasted on your own. You were not told to pray, but you prayed on your own. You were not told to come to church or pay your tithe before you paid your tithe. God is calling you back to your first love. Come back to your first love. Come back to your first love. Your zeal for the Lord, your love for the things of God, God wants you to come back. God wants you to come back to Him. God wants you to come back to Him. God wants you to come back to Him in the name of Jesus. God wants you to come back to Him. God wants you to come back. God is calling you back to Him in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, Branda Kazivarata. God wants you to come back. God wants you to come back. God wants you to come back to Him. He wants you to come back to Him. In the name of Jesus, God wants you to come back to your first love. God is calling you to come back to your first love. The way you used to go to church, the way you used to read your Bible, the way you used to be committed in the things of God. God wants you to come back to Him. He wants you to rededicate your life to Him. He wants you to come back to Him. He's longing after you. He wants you to come back to Him in the name of Jesus. Child of God, it is time to come back to Him. It is time to surrender all to Him. It is time to give Him your best. He wants you to come back to Him. He wants you to come back to Him. It is time to return to the Lord. It is time to return to the Lord. It is time to return to the Lord. He wants you to return to Him. He wants you to come back to Him in the name of Jesus Christ. Return to Him. Return to Him, my darling. He wants you to return back to Him, your first love, the way you used to love Him. The way you used to read your Bible, the way you used to be committed in the things of God, He wants you to return back to Him today. He needs you to return back to Him. He wants you to come back to your first love. where you were not told by any pastor before you worship God, where you were not told by any pastor before you read your Bible on your own, where you did quiet time on your own without being told. He wants you to come back to him. Come back to your first love. He wants you to come back to your first love. Come back to your first love. In the name of Jesus. The last one that we pray, the last point. The echo is too much. The last point that we stand on that to pray. The last point that we pray. When sin no longer is distasteful to you, sinfulness, when you can sin easily and you don't see anything wrong with it. There are people who have gotten to that level where sin is now normal to them. They can lie without feeling any prejudice. They can lie without feeling any prejudice. They can lie without feeling bad about it. You know, I remember years when we were born again years ago. Okay, when we were born again years ago, just play the instrumental for hymns. Just the instrumental for hymns. Okay, I remember where we were born again years ago. When you even made a mistake and you touched a lady's bonbon or you touched her breast mistakenly, some of us, I remember those days when we were in SU and the rest, mistakenly, we even do a 2 days fast just to ask God for forgiveness. Okay, to ask God for forgiveness just by mistakenly touching a lady's bonbon or touching a lady's breast. But today we live in a world where somebody can even go to their boyfriend's house last night, have sex with their boyfriend, and still come to church and come and sing for God. You'll be shocked. People don't care anymore. People can tell a lie. They can lie and they don't feel anything telling them that what you did is wrong. You don't see anything wrong with it. Whether it's they'll tell you, oh, it's a blue lie, it's a yellow lie, it's a green lie. Forgetting that the Bible says that all liars shall inherit the kingdom of darkness. All liars shall go to hell. Whether it is a blue lie, whether it is a yellow lie, the Bible has made it categorically clear that anybody who is a liar will go to hell. And yet, people don't see anything wrong when they lie. People don't see anything wrong to lie. And there are Christians who go to church all right. There are people who call themselves Christians. They go to church all right. But they continuously, perpetually live in sin. I know of Christians who will come and they want to get married and they have been having sex already. They have been exposed to their carnality already before even coming to the pastor to say that they want to get married. I know Christians who live in sin and yet they go to church. They don't care. They don't see anything wrong with it. And if you're a pastor and you talk about sin and you stress on sin, people see you as very outmoded. They don't see you as caring because they need you to teach about 16 ways of success, 25 ways of breaking through in life, which are all good. But I believe that we must get to a stage where sin must smell to you. Where sin must be. You know how if you take something sour in your mouth, you take an orange or a lemon or something which is very sour, or even salt which is sour, you just put it in your mouth. You see how it is, you feel the sourness in your mouth. That is how God wants sin to be sour to a believer. That is how God wants sin to taste to a believer. But it is as though now we condone sin. It is normal to sin. And it's a sign that we are falling away from the Lord. It's a sign that you and I, we are falling away from the Lord. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 1 verse 10. Proverbs 1 verse number 10. The Bible said, my son, listen to what it said. My son, if sinners entice thee, if sinners entice thee, and he said, consent thou not. Consent thou not. Some of us, the people you even call your friends are the people who go to the club and take the shisha and all that. And yet you call them your friend. How can darkness move with light? The Bible says that darkness has nothing to do with light. Light has nothing to do with darkness. So even this year, you have to re-examine those you call your friends. The people you call your friends. I'm not the one saying it. This is the man of wisdom speaking. He said, my son, if sinners entice thee, consent not. Many Christians who walk away from churches or leave a church and backslide are people who often are living in sin. And they only use the leaving the church. I'm leaving the church. I'm leaving the church. It's because of their own sin. That's why they are leaving the church. It's not because somebody offended them. It's not because somebody did something to them. It's just because they are living in sin and their own conscience. They know that the pastor is powerful. Anytime the pastor is preaching, the preaching is choking them. The preaching, and so they can't stand it. And many of you who are in turning point, you know that for me, my preaching, I hear people say my preaching chokes too much. I don't know. Ibas, is it true? Is it true? They say my preaching chokes too much. And so people don't come to church. There are people who prefer to go to a pastor who will water down the gospel to them. God is forgiving. You can continue to live in sin. Even when you come to Father, your salvation is eternal. And doesn't matter what you do, once saved, forever saved. I'm going to be teaching that on Sunday. Why you can lose your salvation. I'm going to be teaching that on Sunday. Why you can lose it. And so we are moved by the enticing words of man's wisdom. We are moved by the doctrine of man. People add the exegesis of the gospel to interpret the scripture. And so people want to go to a place where they massage their ego. They massage their ego. Even though they are doing something wrong, they want you to tell them that whatever you are doing wrong is still right. The Bible says, my son, if sinners entice you, do not consent with them. Do not consent with them. Do not consent with them. We're going to pray. I'll continue next week, Friday. We're going to pray. Maybe you are watching me today. You know you are backsliding. You are falling away from the Lord. God wants to give you an opportunity to come back to Him. That's why we are doing this series, coming back to the Lord. God wants to give you an opportunity to come back to the Lord. Come back to the Lord. Coming back to the Lord. God is giving us an opportunity to come back to Him. He's giving us an opportunity to come back to Him. You want to lift up your voice and say, Father, unto Jesus. Can you play? I surrender. Just increase that volume. The string is okay. Unto Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust in Him. His I surrender all. and say, Father, I have gone far from you. Lord, I have backslidden from you. I have turned my back to you, Lord. Lord, I am coming back like the prodigal son, like the prodigal daughter that I am. Lord, I am coming back to you, Lord. I am coming back. I am coming back to you. I'm coming back to you. Lift up your voice and pray that prayer. Let it come from the sincerity of your heart. Let it come from the sincerity of your heart. Let it come from the sincerity of your heart. And you are saying, Father, I am coming back to you. I am returning back to you. The return. I'm returning back to you, Lord. Lord, have mercy upon me. Lord, have mercy upon me. Anything that I might have done that does not exalt your name, glorify your name. Anything that is drawing me to the well, Lord, let your mercy locate me this morning. Let your mercy locate me this afternoon. Let your mercy locate me. Wherever you are, you want to pray that prayer and say, Father, let your mercy. 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 Makadabada shantela radadabu shanda. Oh Lord, I pray for your mercy. 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 Let your mercy go before me, Lord. Let your mercy precede me, Lord, even as I return to you. Even as I return to you, Lord. Now, I want to play this song for me. Take me back. Take me back, dear Lord. To the place where I first received you. Take me back, there's a song. Take me back, dear Lord, to the place where I, it's by Joe Crutch. Take me back. Lord, take me back to the first place I met you. Lord, take me back to that place. Take me back. Andrew Crouch, Andrew Crouch, Andrew Crouch, that's the name. Manto Sadabalaba Shandalaba. Rabando Sekere Basataya. Lika Bando Rabasiantalaba. Andrew Crouch, take me back. Lord, take me back. Lord, take me back to that place when I first received you. Lord, take me back to that place when I first met you. Manto sadaba nele koshekere bashanda. Imanto skavandele brebelebelebe. Rabando Shakaba Mantolobroski Bandala Baba Baba Baba. Yes, that's the song. Mantola Baya Bala 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 Bala. Manto Shikabaya Bala Baba Baba. Makura Baba Baba Shandala Baba. Makan Makura Bashandere Ataya Bala Baba. Yes, Lord, you want to pray that prayer? Makora bashia taya nele brando shakala baba ima shantala baya tele baya da baba baba rabando shakaba nele baya tala baba imanto da da badianto le bradianta ima shantala ba. You want to say, Lord, take me back, oh God, take me back to that place. Rabando raba, take me back to the place I first received you. Lord, take me back. Lord, take me back. Lord, take me back. Rabba, let it be your sincere prayer this morning. You want to say, Lord, take me back, oh God. Mako rabba shantayaba. Rabba nala bala 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 baba. Rabba nala bala bala baba. Rabba nala bala baba. Lord, take me back, oh God. Mansuri antele. Masianta la bande le branduska bande. Makala bandora baba baya tiri antayaba. Imanto shakala baba baba. Rabando Shakabaya Tayala Baba. Lord, take us back, oh God. Lord, take us back. Lord, take us back. Lord, take us back. Rabalama Shokia Tayaba. Lord is bringing you back to your first love. God is bringing you back to your first love. If only you will believe, He's bringing you back to your first love. He's bringing you back to your first love. He's bringing you back to your first love. Right now, in the name of Jesus. He's bringing you back. He's bringing you back. He's bringing you back. Where you miss, He's bringing you back. He's bringing you back. He's bringing you back. He's bringing you back. His arms are open. His arms are open. He's receiving you back. His arms are open. He's receiving you back. His arms are open. He's receiving you back right now. Rabba rabba shantaya rababa. He's receiving you back. The Lord is receiving you back. Is receiving you back. The Lord is receiving you back. The Lord is receiving you back. Just come back to Him. It doesn't matter what you think. You may think you have kept too long in the world. You think you have kept too long in the world. But His arms are ever open to receive you back to Him. His arms are ever open to receive you back. To receive you back. To receive you back. To receive you back. If only you shall return. If only you will come back to Him. He will receive you back. If only you will return to Him. He will receive you back. He will receive you back. In the name of Jesus. Just give Him a chance to come into your heart. In the name of Jesus Christ. Tomorrow may be too late. Tomorrow may be too late. You may not have the privilege of today. And so today God is calling you back to Him. He's calling you back to Him. He's calling you back to Him. He's calling you back to Him. In the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit. The songwriter said, Lord, take me back when I first received you. Now we are taking our last prayer. Maybe you are watching me. The challenges of life has made you to fall away. Maybe the situations of life. Now play this song for me. Through it all. Through it all, I've learned to trust. It's the same hand you crouch. It's the same hand. Through it, Lord, I've learned to trust in you. Maybe the situations of life is what made you fall away. The challenges of life is what made you to fall away. The problems of life, through it all, I've learned to trust. Through it all. I've learned to trust in the Lord. Through it all, I've learned to trust in the Lord. Just type through it all and you'll crash. I've learned to trust in the Lord. Now, listen to me, child of God. Maybe the challenges of life is what made you to fall away. I want you to pray and ask the Lord for strength. Ask the Lord for the grace. That I may not know what you are going through. Maybe it could be a marital issue. It could be a financial issue. It could be an issue in the office. It could be an issue at your workplace. You want to pray that the Lord will give you the courage. The Lord should give you the courage, the strength to be able to go through that situation and still survive. In the name of Jesus. Because testing is part of the walk with God. Testing is part of it. You will be tested. You will be tested. You will be tested. And so you want to pray and say, Father, Lord, whatever I am going through, Lord, give me the strength. Yes, that's the song. Man, increase the volume for me. Man, go da ba ba da ba ba da ba da ba da ba da ba da ba da ba. Oh, Lord, we will learn to trust you.
To trust in God. Through it all. Sunshine and rain. Through it all.
For the mountains.
Every mountain.
Yeah. If only you can depend on His word, God is going to see you through that storm. God is going to see you through that situation. God is going to see you through it. 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 Maybe you are going through some storm that has made you to backslide, that has made you to fall away from Him. Just know that God is making a way where there seems to be no way. God is making a way where there seems to be no way. God is doing the impossible in your life today. God is doing the impossible. God is doing the impossible. God is doing the impossible. God is doing the impossible in your life. Hey. Lord, we thank you for the valley. Lord, I thank you. To the storms that you brought me through.
If I never had a problem,
I never knew your faithfulness. Hey.
I would never know what faith
God would ever see.
Yeah. Now I tell you,
through it all.
Trust in Jesus.
I've learned to trust in God.
Through the hard times,
through it all,
to the dark days,
through it all,
God never failed me. Through the night,
I've learned to depend upon you.
Sing it again.
I've learned to trust in God. watching me, I want to lift up your offering. If you have your offering, your tithe with you, just lift it up as we pray over it. Lift it higher, lift it higher, lift it higher as we pray over your offering, over your tithe. You want to lift it up as we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, we pray that you bless this seed and this offering and this tithe in the hands of your sons and daughters. I pray that even as they give to support the kingdom and to give to the work of God, I pray that you bless them. You open doors for them. You do the impossible in their lives. In Jesus' name. Father, above all, I pray for them, their families. I pray for their jobs. I pray that you will establish them in whatever they do. That at the end, Lord, we'll be careful to thank you. In Jesus' precious name, I pray. Let somebody say amen. So, child of God, God richly bless you. Call the numbers. You can give your offering by calling the numbers on Zoom, Facebook, and YouTube. You can call the numbers and you can make your donation. The Lord bless you even as you do that. I want to also invite you to watch our program in the evening, the Family Life Series. The Family Life Series. I wanted to join in the Family Life Series. Today we are going to continue answering your questions for you. And so join us, and I trust God that your life will never be the same. The Lord bless you for making time to hear me. I am so honored anytime you make time to listen to me. I pray for you. This week, may you hear good news. May you be celebrated. May the blessing of the Lord and the favor of the Lord come upon you. May doors be open unto you. May the anointing break every limitation in your life. May every setback be broken. May every foothold in your life be broken. May every stronghold in your life be broken. I prophesy into your life. May the mercy and the goodness of the Lord go before you. May you come back to the Lord. May you be healed in every part of your body. In Jesus' name, amen. The Lord bless you even as you make time to watch us. Share the page, share the video until we come your way on Sunday. The Lord richly bless you. On Saturday, I'm going to be on the youth forum. We are talking about masturbation. Take note of that also. The Lord bless you. I love you. I'm going to come your way again. Peace. Shalom.